Let's say you want to transfer a file from one computer to another, and it is really important to know that it's got there intact in one piece. You could send it multiple times and then compare them all, but what generally gets used is something called a hash algorithm. A hash algorithm is kind of like the check digit in a barcode or on a credit card. I think James Grime talked about this a long, long time ago on Numberphile. But the last digit in a barcode or on a credit card is determined by all the other digits on it. And if you change one of those digits, the last one changes as well. So as you type it into a computer, you can know instantly if you've missed a key somewhere. So a hash algorithm is kind of like that, but for an entire file that might be megabytes or gigabytes in size. What it gives you is a code, 16 or 32 or 64 characters, generally hexadecimal. It's basically just one long number expressed in that way, that is a sum up of everything that's in that file. If you crushed it down, if you do all these manipulations to it and crush it down, crush it down, crush it down, and what it comes out with is this thing that says this is a summary of that file. You can never make it work backwards, you can't pull that data back out, but it's like a signature. It's like a confirmation that this file is really who it says it is. The simplest hash algorithm I can think of would just be something like, that's five, add up all the digits in the file, which is 4, 9, 40, 23. That's not a good hash algorithm for a few reasons. Hash algorithms have three main requirements. The first one is speed. It's got to be reasonably fast. It should be able to churn through a big file in a second or two at most. But it also shouldn't be too quick. If it's too quick, it's easy to break, and I'll explain that later. The second requirement is that if you change one byte, one bit, anywhere in the file, at the start, at the middle, at the end, then the whole hash should be completely different. This is something called the avalanche effect. If you're interested in how this is achieved, do look up the actual algorithms themselves. It'd take me an hour to explain sort of vaguely how they work in a friendly way, but if it's your kind of thing, do look it up. But suffice it to say, if one bit gets flipped anywhere in the message, then the whole hash is completely and utterly different. The third requirement is that you've got to be able to avoid what are called hash collisions. This is where you have two documents which have the same hash. Now, obviously, there is a mathematical principle called the pigeonhole principle. You have, if you have 50 pigeons and 25 pigeonholes, you have to stuff two pigeons into one of the pigeonholes. That's a terrible analogy when you say it like this, but if I explain it, there are incredible numbers of documents out there possible. The hash, meanwhile, is just one fairly long number. There will be files out there which naturally have the same hash. And that's okay, because the odds against it are so unlikely that we can deal with that. It's never going to happen naturally. But if you can artificially create a hash collision, if you can, say, create a file and change a name, then we have a problem. And that's where security comes into these. Because if I can make a file that sums to a certain hash, then I can fake documents. I can send different things and have this signature match. So let's say I have an important document, something that's, I don't know, the permission to go to the moon. I don't know why I said that. Permission to go to the moon, let's say that. And it's got someone's name on it. And that file is sent, and along with it, through other channels, comes this hash to verify that this is actually the document. Now let's say I can intercept that file, and I can change it, but because the hash algorithm is broken, I can change it, I can change the name, I can change the date, I can change whatever, and I can send someone else to the moon because I can make this hash the same through carefully tweaking the bytes. Now, it's incredibly difficult to do that. In practice, you'd want a massive file and a lot of computer code. But there are old hash algorithms like MD5, which was used for many, many years, which now have these collisions out in the wild and are considered broken. Because you can get a file, not like a document with text in, but a computer code, anything like that, where it's possible to send something malicious and have it come out with the same hash. So this is important. This is where speed comes in. If the hash is too slow, no one will want to use it. But if the hash is too fast, if you can create new ones in a few processor cycles, then you can fairly easily create documents that match a particular hash. It is, in a very real sense, an arms race. As I said, for many years, MD5 was the accepted algorithm, and it's still used for a few things. But MD5 is now thoroughly broken because computers are fast enough, and there are a few sort of interesting tricks you can use to try and create hash collisions deliberately. The other problem with MD5 is because it was used so much, and it was used everywhere on the web, Google has become an exceptionally good resource for breaking them. You wouldn't want to store a password this way. I'll talk about that in a later video. Don't use something like this for storing passwords. But people did. For many years, people did. And in a lot of cases, a word will be stored next to its MD5 hash for some reason. If you type an MD5 hash into Google, frequently the word it was hashing comes out, which means that for pretty much every word in the English language and a lot of other passwords besides, the MD5 can be solved by typing it into Google. So MD5 is comprehensively, constantly broken. So everyone moved to something called SHA-1. And now there are rumours that that might start to be broken soon if it hasn't already, because computers keep getting faster. Hash collisions are easier to generate. So everyone is moving to SHA-2, which for the time being is secure. SHA-3 is going through the process of being ratified by all the agencies now, and in a few years, that'll be the standard. Ultimately, I should really emphasise this. Don't use this for storing passwords. I'll talk about that in a later video. These are used for verifying files, for verifying transmission, and that's all they should be used for. There is one last thing, which is that occasionally you will see download sites offering software who say that here's the file we're going to send you, and click there to download it, and if you want to be safe, here's the hash of the file so you can be sure it's the right one. That's a terrible idea. I mean, it'll verify you've got the download intact, but they're selling this as, we guarantee that this software is safe and you can check it against that hash. Which is a bad idea, because if someone has been able to get into their website and change the software they're sending, it's pretty trivial to change that hash as well. So there you go, that is hash algorithms. That is taking a big chunk of data and turning it into a small amount to verify it. And in a later video, I will talk about how that's used and how that shouldn't be used for actually keeping things secure.
This episode of Computerphile was brought to you by audible.com, and you can go to audible.com/computerphile and download a free book. They've got a huge range and you can listen to it on all kinds of devices, your phone or in the car, things like that. I was thinking about a book to recommend, and it made me think about the first audiobook I ever listened to. And that was Treasure Island, and I listened to it on a cassette next to my bed as I was going to sleep each night. I checked the Audible website, they do have Treasure Island, so that's my recommendation today. Why don't you check it out? audible.com/computerphile, free book, and thanks to them for supporting our videos.